So please welcome Mrinalini. Thank you, Mrinalini.
Glad to be here.
For coming to my house.
And thank you for the lovely looking khichdi.
I've given you very little now, then I will serve more. But before that, let me tell you that your name is very long.
Yes.
Can I call you Minu?
You can call me Mrin.
My Rina. R? Rina? Okay. So I will try calling you, but my R and R, which I have no knowledge of what is the difference, but I'm for sure will screw it up.
I had an aunt called Minu and I didn't quite like her, so.
But I'm not your aunt, I'm your body. Okay, so you are a lawyer and lawyer turned psychotherapist.
Yes, in the middle of it was also another piece of work, but I will share that as we go along.
And two different profession. One is like very strong, very very masculine profession, and the other is very docile, soft profession, right? I still prefer the latter one because being a lawyer means always shouting, screaming, you know, tarikh pe tarikh, tarikh pe tarikh, like, you know, always screaming, you know. But I'm very happy that you are here because let me tell you that she's very different. She, though she's wearing masculine clothes, but she's also very feminine. She has long hair. So I'm very happy today. So from two different profession, how did you manage?
Well, it isn't I managed the switch, but tarikh pe tarikh is Sunny Deol screaming on stage in a movie in front of the camera, which is very different from actually what lawyers end up doing. But yeah, it can, I mean, while more women have entered the profession, it can still have this picture of being a very masculine profession and has that energy of, you know, it does have a thoda aggressive jaakar ke, you know, you have to forcefully put your point forward, whether you're litigating, even when you're in corporate law, all of that. The transition for me was very obvious in some way. When I wanted to work, I wanted to work with people. And really, when I was studying and we do many, many internships, I realized that law is not really working with people as much as it's working on people. And I didn't see myself being in that role.
But you are, I'm cutting you, but she's from a national law school, big name, big tag. But I don't see... I don't know, I'm actually confused.
So the big name, big tag is there, it has followed me. It's been very helpful in many ways because people associate many good things with the institution. But I think it's very important, whether as men or women, just as people, to have the freedom to say, this role doesn't sit well with me. Even though many people said, oh, because of your personality, you will fit a lawyer's role very well. And I always wanted to go into litigation. My heart just wasn't in it after a point. So I did explore different things. And when I started studying psychology, which was quite by accident actually, I loved it. And I said, to me this, and again, I think the perception you're talking about is accurate. It's people sometimes think it's soft and it's gentle and you're very, you know, you're this kind, bleeding heart, listening to everybody. It isn't exactly like that. It has a lot of rigor and it has a lot of firmness in it. And you don't work just with this, you know, it's not at all the bleeding heart actually. Yeah, a lot of the work is about being able to be direct, to very incisively see what is going on, have the language to put it across in a way that is compassionate, but not coddling.
You see, when I, the moment you say ki working lady, I would think teacher, you know, or doctor, who are very, you know, they can feel the pain, like more of not sympathy, but empathy, no?
So sympathy and empathy bahut confuse ho jata hai kabhi kabhi. And you can have empathy in any profession you're in. You can have empathy as a lawyer. You can have empathy as a doctor. You should have empathy as a doctor. You can have empathy and you, again, as a therapist as well, it is important to have that. But I think the idea of sometimes as a woman having to prove that I can do something as masculine as be a lawyer, that used to play on my mind initially. The actual transition, there were no two ways about it. The minute I started studying psychology, I said, this is what I love and this is how I want to, what I want to do and how I want to contribute. But sometimes I would think that, you know, there is a certain, I mean, people would say, I would often hear, But from national law school, you could have been a lawyer. Yeah. And they really, you know, I say, wo thodi chhati chaudi ho jaati hai. And I would think about that, especially when I was struggling and learning and not quite sure what direction this will take. Because in India, mental health is evolving now. It's a profession that's evolving now. 15 years ago, it was still a little bit under the wraps. And in that sense, not many people knew about it. So I would, the power of it, the excitement of it, I would miss that. But I think this has a very different meaning and depth to it that I quite enjoy.
So how was it when you were growing up? When did you have what kind of background? What did your family think? Like feminist type?
So I'm the middle child of three sisters. So I think being three sisters, we did a lot of challenging of what is expected. It would always be, so my parents tried very hard not to bring us up with this how girls should be and how boys should be. And I think they succeeded to quite an extent. And as we went out in the world also, we'd really say, why? If a boy can do that, why can't we? And that would be a challenge we would throw out very often. Even in our larger family, because I spent a few years in a joint family, there wasn't really so much gender differentiation. You know, oftentimes you hear around the time, you know, boys and girls hit puberty, you can't play together and all of that. We didn't have that, but there was definitely gendered thinking, which we picked up very subtly. And I realized after I got married that, somewhere my thinking is also, while in college, through school, I was very card-carrying, flag-bearing feminist. Sometimes I would have to, I was confronted by my own confusion on the issue. And I'd wonder what sits well for me now. And I'd have to keep redefining and questioning and reworking what kind of feminist I see myself as.
But you look like somebody who is equality. And when you are not, no, when you look at her, you don't feel ke, achha, she is one of those candlelight maar, JNU ke samne baithne ka, dharna dalne ka, nahi?
Maine bahut dharne dale hain.
I was thinking that you are very different. That's what made me happy. When you look at her, she's very this docile thing, shy and all. But again, dharna, baba, you are just changing my thoughts about you.
And I think that's part of being able to redefine and reinvent yourself. If I was, and I've done the petitions and I've done the dharnas and I've done the standing in marches outside in the sun and all of that. And I don't think that's a bad route to take. But I don't think I need to be nailed to that identity or that version of myself. I at no point stopped identifying as a feminist or started thinking differently about that. It's just as I've changed in my life, I've had to revisit that and say, what does it mean today for me? And I think having the freedom to do that is something that's really important to being able to evolve and grow as people and take some of these identities that we give ourselves or we take on along with us so that there's authenticity, so that you're really, you know, who you are today aligns with how you show up in these spaces and isn't just one, acha, ek time pe dharna pe baithte the. It doesn't mean I won't do it again if I find the need for it.
Well, I do think that's such a waste of time. Like, see, now when my kids are going to school, I have so much time to spend in the kitchen. Mm. And now you can see me cooking and all. I'm a very happy person, but only going dharna and such a waste of time, no?
No, I don't think it's a waste of time. It depends a lot on what it's for and how do you... I think sometimes just seeing numbers and numbers of people showing up, just wo, that feeling ki hum akele lad rahe hain kisi cheez ke liye, or struggling and suffering with something, I think that feeling lifts very significantly when you see numbers behind you, numbers with you. Mm-hmm. And I remember, I mean, we used to, when we were in hostel, we were in college and we had a lot of challenges around how boys had different curfew timings and girls had different curfew timings. And we were in college, it was a proper professional course. So we would petition, we would raise, awareness, we'd go talk to people. And here a lot of very interesting inputs. I mean, you'd be surprised. We think that one generation thinks like that, another generation thinks in a different way. But even in our own generation, you'd have some very progressive views and some very regressive perspectives that would come.
So tell me, now you are a psychotherapist, means you are very soft and nice. I mean, you also come across like that. So that probably would have been easier for you, you know, when you got married and you know you had to talk to your in-laws. I mean, from a psychotherapist point of view, you can understand that, oh, this person though wants this thing, then let me change myself or however. So it was easy, no?
I'm going to love sharing this video with people, because when you say soft and nice, not everyone's going to be jumping up and agreeing with that. There are many different sides. It's soft and nice is great till you have a need to not be as soft and nice. And I think particularly when we find ourselves in situations where our identity or sense of self is challenged, then I think other sides of us do need to emerge. And did I do a great job understanding my in-laws because I'm a psychotherapist? Not always.
You had gender issues with in-laws?
I can't imagine somebody getting married in this country, or maybe in any country, not having gender issues when it comes to in-laws, or comes to getting married, moving into a new context, new family. Even if you don't live with them, but understanding of, you know, families, I think in India, if you say what is a typical Indian family, you'll find such different variations to it. So, of course, there were gender issues in terms of what is expected. And I think when I say reinventing and redefining myself is in, as a feminist, once I was married, once I was in different, once I was working also, took some effort, because it was very easy to rely on what we call in psychology the cultural parent. This notion of how we should be. The minute you get married, what are you relying on? What is your biggest example of a married woman? It's usually...
Mother.
Absolutely. Mothers, aunts, people you've seen when you were growing up. And we don't quite know, okay, what is the role I want to take? So that transition of redefining your role, of understanding what fits, what doesn't fit, which parts are good to take, which parts are good to get rid of, took a long time. For example, I mean, I had some of the very typical pressures of learning to cook, and I had never cooked. I'd cooked for fun or just to survive.